Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick, your favorite brother from another mother. Hallelujah. I just want to make it a prayer request, administrative video here first. Number one, I ask for your prayers because I'm asking for guidance and wisdom from the Lord of how to do all my travels and the timing, etc. Exactly. But right now, I'll be leaving the Dallas-Fort Worth area for a season, and I'm going to be driving up to Rochester, New York area. I'll be up there. Myself and my wife, will be up there the last 2 weeks of August. Basically, starting August the 20th, I will be there until the end of the month, and I'll be going to Morristown, New Jersey for a deliverance on the Labor Day weekend. That's the weekend of the 2nd and 3rd, whatever it is, the 1st and 2nd of September. I will be in the Morristown, New Jersey area, very close to Newark and New York and all that. I will probably have time to see people there because I spend at least 2 nights there, and maybe I'll be able to finish the deliverance in one day. I'm not sure, but it's all up to the Lord. But if you're in that area near Morristown, New Jersey, you want to contact me, we can meet up probably that Saturday night or Sunday of Memorial Day or Labor Day weekend. Just let me know, and we can try to make an appointment. Be leaving there, and I should be driving. I'm not sure. I'm praying about going to South Carolina for a week, seeing people in the coastal area, and then seeing people in the Pawleys Island area, and then going to see a meeting in Greenville, South Carolina. So if you're in Greenville, South Carolina, you want to do another revival. I'm praying about it, and just I want to hear from those. You know, we had a nice meeting last time. We just got a little bit of a breakthrough. It would be nice to go much higher in the Lord, but we had a nice meeting. And so by the grace of God, I'll be going back through Greenville. So it's all up to the Lord. So just let me hear from you. That would be like the 2nd week of September. Then my tentative schedule is to be in Boise, Idaho the next weekend. So either the 2nd or 3rd week in September, I'll be in Boise. So I'm praying about that, to lock that in as soon as possible. I plan on locking it in this week, this coming week. This is starting tomorrow, Monday. Lock this in. And I've just been praying about it, waiting to hear from the Lord. So I have a new event that has come up and don't have it locked in yet, but it'll be after that. Probably the last weekend in September, be having a men's retreat at a ranch. Going to go full on cowboy, you know, chuck wagon. We're going to go full-fledged chuck wagon, men's spiritual retreat, men's fellowship retreat and revival. Will be either the 3rd or 4th weekend in September here on a ranch about 2 hours west of Fort Worth. Out near Breckenridge, Texas. So I'm waiting to hear from you. I know there's a dear sister who I communicate with and who has a husband and 3 sons, maybe that live nearby that area, as a matter of fact. So who knows who all will show up. And it'd be great if we had some young guys, but we already have several, you know, grown men who are interested in coming. And it's just a matter of locking in the exact weekend. So we're working on that. And I ask you guys to pray about that, the men's fellowship retreat, and we'll be seeking the Lord. We'll be having fellowship too, but we're going to spend a day seeking the Lord and a day of fellowshipping and discussing all the things that might pertain to men's ministry. And I ask for your prayers for that. And if some of you sisters who are regular viewers of mine, if you'd like to send your husband, if you can get him to go, it'd be great. I mean, the biggest problem in the church today is men. In the Philippines, it's much worse, but in the States, it's also, the church is, they claim, which when I learned, went to school, they said it was 60% women, 40% men. I think it's less than men than that. But so we need men is a big deficit in the church. And, and we need men to, especially younger guys, as all of you guys know, the millennials, men. They've been feminized and babied so much and protected from bullying so much. They cannot compete in the world, the manliness of competition and the way that men operate. And out in the real world, in this world, where we have to live and compete, there's so much masculinity and so much feminism that it's just basically nearly part of the enemy's plan to destroy men, and which leads to destroying the family. And so when I'm just talking on that topic, hear so many young women saying, where are the gentlemen at, and where are all the real men at? And I would say that feminism, and of course, men are raised by 99% men are raised by their mother. So, it's up to parents, mothers and fathers, to instill manliness or to teach and direct women to be women and men to be men. People copy and pattern themselves after their parents a lot. And so that's what men need to do. Grown men need to be an example to and lead their family in Christ. And that's what's missing in the church, a huge part of what's wrong with the church. The Lord had led me to write that book that I wrote, and one of the chapters in there is about that whole thing, that the devil's plan is to bring in the new world order. And how does he do that? Through many ways. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll is one of the chapters, new age, abortions and all this, and birth control and all that, which leads to, family planning is cool. When I say family planning, I mean birth control, not abortion. But family planning is a great idea for married people. But what ends up happening is birth control made a way where, the fear of getting pregnant was removed. The restraint of unwanted pregnancy was removed in the 1960, or when the birth control pill started, I think it's 1960 or 61. And this opened the door, one of the big doors to this, what they call the sexual revolution, that got us where we are today. And of course, this is all Satan's plan, Satan's idea to destroy the family. How does he destroy it? So many ways. Gay marriage. The whole point of that is to make an abomination and a mockery of what God designed, Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. Make a mockery to get the fathers out of the house. Look at the great society that was done in the 1960s and what they've done to inner city communities. They want to do, and they are doing it, they're trying to do it to everybody, to boost that illegitimacy rate, and I wrote in the book about that too, the exact statistics, which I can't remember off the top of my head, but the illegitimacy rate in the inner city went from, maybe it was 20% or whatever it was, to 90%. And then in wealthy people, illegitimacy rate went from 5% to whatever it is today, 40 or 50% or something like that. You have to look up the statistics. But these are factors that destroy the family unit, the way God designed things to be, to have a family. And a family unit led by the husband, like Fathers Knows Best, not the modern day TV shows where the man is a buffoon and a moron and an idiot and just another child and the wife is the leader. So you see lots of men who are acting out that role of being the buffoon, the moron. Every commercial you see, the dad is the moron and the mom is the only one with any sense. And this, of course, is the message, because the devil knows that the man, a godly man leading his family in proper godly order, is a very dangerous thing to the kingdom of darkness. And so when the devil can destroy that, it's just one of the building blocks of a Christian nation. Nations are made of states. States are made of communities. Cities. Cities are made of communities. Communities are made of neighborhoods. Neighborhoods are made of families. So the family is the basic unit of our society. So if you have lots of strong Christian families, you're going to end up with strong community, leading to a strong city, state, strong nation. So the basics of that. So that's why the whole thing about all this nationalism, the social media and all this and television, all that, people get the idea that, you know, it's like identifying as, oh, we as Americans do ABC. Well, we as Americans identify with, you know, freedom of speech and freedom of religion and right to bear arms or whatever and all that, the Constitution. But we as, and we, you know, English is our national language, no matter what anybody says. But we, our higher priority, of course, as a Christian, is to God. And then number two is to our home. And then number three is our country. So our part of making America great and stopping shootings at the mall and all this is to do our part in our own family, you know. And so many people sitting around watching Fox News and CNN and getting, you know, socially active, but yet, you know, you got your own family, you know. And so we have to give our priority to our families. And so that's the kind of things that we need to talk to the men about. Young men need to be, see role models in this and strong Christian dads. There's lots of young people that don't have, like, well, you know, I came from a nominal Christian background, like many of you guys who even came from no dad. And then some of us had a dad that wasn't really much of a Christian or not at all. Some of you guys had an atheist dad, whatever, alcoholic abusive dad, etc., all kinds of stuff. But it doesn't matter where you're born the first time. It's where you're born the second time, right? To be born again. As they say, born once, die twice. Born twice, die once. You know, unless you're raptured, then you won't die at all. So you figure that one out. That's a theological statement in one line. Born twice, born once, you die twice. If you're born twice, you'll only die once. Unless you're raptured. I add that as a caveat. So praise God. If you're born as a, no matter, even as the Lord Jesus told Nicodemus, you know, you must be born again. So it's the second birth, the new birth, the spiritual birth, to become born again Christian. That is the birth that gets you from not being part of the second death. As the Bible says, blessed are those, you know, who are not part of the second death, right? And the second death are those who are involved in the great white throne judgment of the Lord for all non-Christians or non-believers, the people that are going to hell, the people that will be in hell and the lake of fire and all that, the whatever their judgment is from God, their punishment, lake of fire and all that. And brothers and sisters, praise God. I pray that everyone watching this video will not be part of that and that you will do your part to keep others out of the second death and help everyone to be involved in the second birth and not the second death. Praise God, brothers and sisters. So I ask you guys to pray about these things. As I said, so I've already locked in to be in Rochester, New York area, and another place called, I can't pronounce it right, is it called Palermo? It's not Palermo, is it? Let's see, I was looking at it here. I had the name written down. Palmery, that's just near Rochester, maybe an hour, 45 minutes. Southeast of Rochester, I'll be in a place called Palmery. Also, New York. During that time, and I'll be meeting, I'm going to have a meeting there. I'm going to be meeting at least with one dear sister and her husband just passed this last week. This dear sister. As a matter of fact, those who watch my videos, I asked you guys to pray for Brother Bill and Sister Nora. Well, Brother Bill passed just last week since I made that video. And he had the same thing my mom had. So there you go. It's those of you who watch my videos, you know what I'm talking about. That's what I'll say. So I'll be doing a meeting there with her and inviting, you know, and she said, hey, let's get some people. So anybody wants to meet there, that'll be sometime in the last week of August. Maybe even going into Friday, which will be August 31st. How about Friday, August 31st? Because I'll be on my way to New Jersey. So we can do that. And then I'll just go to New Jersey on Saturday and Sunday. That will be September 1st and 2nd, maybe, or something like that, in Morristown, New Jersey. Okay, and then from there, as I said, I'll be going to South Carolina. I need to hear from the people in Greenville and the Pawleys Island area during that next week, the week after Labor Day, and then the next week. I'm just trying to figure out whether I'll drive back to Dallas, Fort Worth, and then fly to up to Boise, or if I'll try to go from North Carolina and then come back and then go to Dallas. I mean, it's just a matter of, I guess, what's the cheapest plane ticket and all that. I have no idea. I'm just praying about it. I ask you guys to pray for wisdom on that. But I'll be probably flying into either Salt Lake or Seattle. I was going to fly into Seattle if I was going straight to the Philippines. See, this is what I have to deal with, brothers and sisters, all the schedule. But it's for the Lord. But it's much easier to fly from Seattle to the Philippines. But if I'm going to go to Boise and then go back to Dallas for the Cowboy Ranch Men's Fellowship the end of September, then it might be, I know it's cheaper, and it might be faster and easier to fly into Salt Lake City because it's only maybe, say, 4 hours from Boise, whereas Seattle is 6 hours. But I know I have many people. I've been to Seattle, met lots of people in Seattle before. So I haven't talked to the people in Seattle in a long time. So, you know, if anybody's in the Seattle area, let me know. I know there's one brother in Salt Lake City that I know of. So I don't know. I also have to plan what's best to meet, you know, the most amount of people that I can minister to and visit with. It's also a factor. That's what I have to deal with all the time, brothers and sisters. You know, unless I hear specifically from the Lord, which sometimes I do. The Lord will specifically tell me go. One time the Lord told me go to Dallas and stay for 3 days. And that was what I did. That's 2014. And it was a great time in the Lord. And then sometimes, like, he told me to do the revival in Greenville. And we did. So praise God. Other times it's just like people contact me and say, hey, can you come to Seattle? And I hear from like 3 or 4 people just in a day or two out of the blue to come to Seattle. So, well, it must be from the Lord because these people don't know each other and they're all contacting me at the same time asking me to come to Seattle as an example. So I'm like, hey, it must be from the Lord. So, you know, the Lord does things in different ways. So that's all those details of it are not exactly worked out, brothers and sisters. I ask for your prayers about that. But as I said, Rochester's locked in, New York State and Morristown, New Jersey. The only thing I'm going to make a new rule for deliverance ministry, that the immediate family has to be on board or I'm not going to do it. And of course, I have to give the caveat unless the Lord tells me to. Otherwise, my personal rule, unless the Lord overrides me and tells me to go, I will not do deliverances unless the immediate family is on board. So as an example, in Morristown, New Jersey, there's a question whether the family's going to be on board. If the family's not on board, I'm not going to do it unless the Lord commands me to. So for right now, I'm believing that the family, I'm going to talk to them, and they're going to talk to me before I go there. As an example, I'm just using as an example to the sister and family in Morristown, New Jersey. Nobody knows who you are. I'm just saying this for future reference to anybody that watches my videos for their situation maybe. So I've already got everything, seems to be on board, and everybody's all fired up for the Boise trip. So I have many people I'm meeting in Boise, so I'd be excited to meet all you guys up there in the Boise, Idaho area. And even if I fly into Seattle, I'm still planning on driving, be going near, I actually have a relative in the Lake Tahoe, Reno area. And so I may drive down there to visit them. I haven't seen them in many, many years since my uncle died. So I might go visit my relative there. I need to, you know, if I have time and the energy to do it. And so I can meet people along the way, whatever. Reno, Nevada, Lake Tahoe area. And so, you know, maybe somebody's in that area who's watching my videos too in Reno. So who knows? And it'll all work out, you know, that I can meet with people while I'm there. So that's why I always try to make the, you know, get the most out of my time. And, you know, the cost to go to do the most good for the most people with the least amount of time and finances, or unless otherwise commanded by the Lord specifically. And so that's how it is, brothers and sisters. You want to serve the Lord. And be in the ministry, you have to be led by the Lord, and you have to be open to being flexible to go do what the Lord wants you to do. So I was planning on going straight to the Philippines after I was in Boise, but the Lord seems to be lining up this men's retreat. So I'll be coming back to Dallas-Fort Worth because I only have one purpose in life. My number one purpose is to do God's will and do whatever He wants me to do. Second purpose is to be the proper husband and father to my family. And then after that, it's, of course, you know, country or whatever is needed, which I did that already. I was already in the Army 10 years, already served in Iraq and all that stuff. So by the grace of God, I won't have to do any more of that, any more things like that. But praise God, brothers and sisters. I'm excited about all the meeting all the brothers and sisters. I won't say I'm excited about traveling, but I'm excited about ministering and visiting all the brothers and sisters. I'll be going back through Nashville So if Mama Kirby, she always watches my videos, and we probably do another video. Of course, we can do it on the internet. So maybe if Mama Kirby wants to meet up again, I might be ready to do that sometime around the 17th, 18th of August. I'll be passing through there. So I've met with people in Nashville before, too. I did some water baptisms in Nashville, and there's another, as a matter of fact, I had two or three people in Nashville was asking me to baptize them. I don't think, it never, the second trip never worked out, so I don't know. Maybe there's people in Nashville that want to be baptized. You can let me know. I can always do that. Hey, it's up to the Lord. That's what I'm saying. You got to do all that we can do, brothers and sisters. Praise God. Anyway, brothers and sisters, it's been a blessing to be here in the Fort Worth area. A lot of blessings, and there's a few people hungry for the Lord. I wish there was many more, but I know God has a plan, and I know the Lord wants me to start a deliverance revival center somewhere in this area. I say that even though the Lord's already told me, and I know, I just want to, you know, confirm that, but maybe when I get back here in September, I'll go ahead and get it started. I mean, I'm just stepping very gently and slowly, because before I, you know, take that jump, you know, the leap of faith, I'm just making sure I get it, hear it clearly, a couple of times clearly from the Lord. But at least, brothers and sisters, we should always be cautious. As long as it's not an emergency, we should be cautious. We should be faithful and be obedient, but we should also be cautious too sometimes. You know, unless the Lord speaks to us loud and clear, and those of you who interact with the great I am, because God is not the great I was, but the great I am, then you know what I mean. Sometimes we hear loud and clear and urgently from the Lord, and sometimes it's a still small voice, and we have to be like, wait a minute, I want to make sure that I heard clearly from the Lord. Because, you know, we don't want to waste resources, we don't want to waste time, and we don't, you know, we don't want to get out of with the will of God. We want to stay in His will. And so, brothers and sisters, that's life in Christ. It's all about with the Lord. It's all about the journey. Believe it or not, with the Lord, it's all about our personal daily walk with Him. It's the most important thing with the Lord. He, you know, it's not about people say all that stuff about, you know, you somebody 1 million people to the Lord, somebody did this. What would a man give in exchange for his soul, Jesus said? Or what does it do? Good does it do you to gain the whole world and lose your soul? So the most important thing with the Lord is our personal walk with Him, to be one of His sheep and to follow Him and stay with Him. And then anything else we do above and beyond that, it's just a bonus. It's just gravy, brothers and sisters, to be a servant of the Lord and walk with Him and develop your relationship with Him and to, you know, to sanctify yourselves, to separate ourselves from the world and walk with the Lord. You know, that's what He wants. And then after that, you know, it's what He can trust us with, what we're willing to take a chance to do, you know, risking ourselves for by faith to do His will, like going to the Philippines, going to remote areas, into rebel-controlled areas in the Philippines. I've done that in the past. Yeah, it was something that I knew the Lord wanted me to do, so I did it. Just as an example, there's lots of people done lots of other things for the Lord, much more than that. But it's an example of, you know, the Bible says, without faith, it's impossible to please God, and He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. So, you know, lack of faith is not pleasing to the Lord. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So it's faith, faith, faith. But when it comes to specific instructions that are not written in the Bible, you know, the Lord tells you, I mean, you know, you don't need the Lord to tell you that you need to be born again because the Bible says that. But if the Lord, if you feel the Lord is leading you to, you know, quit your job and, you know, and go be an evangelist or go be a pastor or whatever, you know, you want to make sure that's correct. You want to confirm your calling in Christ and what He wants you to do. If He wants you to move from Dallas to Utah or whatever, and take a job there, or, you know, try to evangelize Mormons or whatever you could possibly think of, that's not in the Bible, specific instructions for you like that. You know what I mean? It's different than, you know, the general. It's like in the Army. They have general orders and specific orders, special orders. So there's three general orders that every soldier has to memorize when you go to basic training. And we have to memorize those, and those are general orders that apply to everybody. But when you're on guard duty somewhere, every guard post, like if you were guarding some nuclear missiles, they've got specific special orders for that job. That's not the same as guarding, I don't know, whatever, guarding a, you know, some tanks or guarding a chicken coop. I don't know. It would not be the same level of and details of rules. So it's the same thing with the Lord. He gives us, we all have general orders from the Lord. And that's a pretty good one. I think I'll use that with, at the men's retreat. That's something that men can understand. We have our general orders that we all need to follow. To be born again, we should be water baptized. We should seek to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You don't have to be baptized in the Holy Spirit to be saved, but we should seek a further work of the Spirit of God in our hearts. Specifics on that, I will give you, I have my doctrinal statement and deep teaching on that, a deeper teaching on that, on my one of my websites. Praise God, the Lord's made a way. We got two or three websites. I never talk about them, but we have one, Church of the Firstborn. The link is below all my videos. And on there, I have a statement of faith with 14 cardinal points of faith. And then I have a page specifically addressing the baptism of the Holy Spirit and a little more teaching on it and dividing up the word about the topic. So if you're interested in there, you can go to the below this video in the See More section. Look for Church of the Firstborn link, and you can go there and read about it. And it gives lots of Bible verse references and stuff I've got there. And you know, and you can always email me with questions. After you read that and you still have questions, feel free to email me. My email address is below every video, neartochrist@aol.com. And I'll be glad to help you guys. So anyway, I want to make some more videos of preaching, which I'll do later. Probably it's getting late now, maybe tomorrow. But I'm going to get this loaded. God bless you all. Love you all in the Lord. God bless.